It's all about what is the purpose of your life. If you want to make tons and tons of money, okay, go ahead and make money. But if you want to see a world different from what we have, better than what we have, then you will be choosing the world. Solving problems with business. So that idea of social business started coming. We kept creating business after business to solve problems. We create energy company, solar energy company, to bring solar energy in the villages because they don't have electricity. So we created Grameen Shakti to sell solar home system. We tell them, the villagers, they don't understand what is solar home system. We tell them, give the money which we spend on kerosene every month. You promise to do that? I give you a solar home system right today. So there's nothing expenditure for you. Just what you spend on your kerosene. You do it for 3 years, and the whole system will be yours. You don't have to pay a penny to me anymore. You get solar energy free. Because I got the money back what I spent on you. People, this is a good idea. I have nothing to lose. I'm only spending money what I spent on kerosene. Today, Grameen Shakti has reached nearly 2 million homes, 1.8 million homes with solar energy. So instead of kerosene, which is fossil fuel damaging to the planet, I replaced them, gave them the renewable energy, take the sunshine, and now there's a big flood in Bangladesh. Almost 1/3 of the country is under flood. We're running irrigation pumps for agriculture for the dry season with solar energy. So we say, now the flood is here, there's no drinking water. So run the solar-driven pumps to produce clean water, distribute to all the people, free, because it doesn't cost me anything. Because the pump is there, pedal is there, sun is there, just get the water. Can be whatever use, which we didn't plan at that time. But today is possible. We didn't create this company to make money for anybody. We created to substitute the oil, the kerosene, by solar. In a way, people will enjoy. And they did enjoy. Now there are lots of other NGOs are coming to sell solar home system. We put together, there are nearly 4 million homes in Bangladesh now with solar energy. See? Again, another idea to make use of the concept of social business. You can do that. So the idea is spreading. We see every day problems, but we don't get involved in it. Because now this is not my job. There are big companies who run businesses to make big money, multinational companies. They don't see the problems which other people will see, because they're so busy making money. One company called McKay became very interested in the concept of social business. This is a Canadian company. They started chasing me to meet me, talk to me how to do social business. They got excited about the idea of social business. Finally, we got together, discussed it. They said, we want to do something on social business. I said, okay, that's okay. So we got together to start a social business in Colombia, because we were also involved in Colombia trying to solve their problem in a social business way. Colombia had an interesting, or a bad problem, I shouldn't say interesting. They lost the coffee market. Colombian coffee, I don't know if you are familiar with that. Colombian coffee lost all the market in the world. Because Vietnamese coffee, Indonesian coffee took out all the top place. So the investors in Colombian coffee, which is most American companies, they just withdrew their business from Colombia because nobody is buying their topic. They started investing in Vietnam and Indonesia. But what happened to the coffee growers? They could not go to Vietnam to start doing this thing. They can without any income. So that was the challenge that came to us. So we said, okay, McCain, let's do it here. We switched the crop from coffee to potato. Because McCain is a potato company. When they came to see me, after we discussed a little while, I said, can you tell me what kind of business you have? Because I didn't know anything about them. The guy said, do you like French fry? I said, yeah, I like French fry. So next time you eat French fry anywhere in the world, remember you are eating McCain French fry. I said, oh my God, you're big. She said, yes, you're big. So that's the company who controls 60% of the French fry market in the whole world. We said, we want to grow potato with these people. Let's create a social business. We created the social business, named it Campo Vivo. It's a beautiful program. But that's not the story that I was going to tell. They got so excited. They are the largest buyer of potato in Europe. They came back to think, you know, in France, which is our major partner in our potato business, 26% of the potato grown in France are thrown away. Why? Because 6% of the potato cannot be picked up from the ground because the big machines that are brought in, they cannot catch every single potato. So 6% on an average remains under the ground, never picked up. And it's a cost to the farmers, a cost to the company who are buying the potato because they are charging it to buyers. And it ultimately comes back to the French fry eaters. 20% of the potato are never sold. It's picked up, but never sold. Why? They have wrong shape. They're not nice round shape. They're not good for the machines which produce French fry. So the companies don't buy. Since companies don't buy, farmers have no use. Who want to eat tons and tons of potato? Nobody buys. So they just throw it away, plow it back into the ground, and say, 26%. Now, this time they became interested in social business, did they come over here again? Became interested in social business. For the first time, they saw this 26% potato wasted away. Until then, they never noticed it. This is part of their life. Suddenly, the guy who was the head of this operation in France, of McCain, why are we wasting this? It could be good social business. He created a beautiful social business. Buy all these potatoes at a very cheap price because they throw it away, so people sell it for any price. And then make potato soup. For all these years, it never occurred to our head that this is a food we can use in another version. Because soup doesn't need a shape. French fry needs a shape. Soup doesn't need a shape. So it became very popular soup in France. It's a social business soup. And the French chef offering their special recipe of potato soup for social business with their images and so on. Now everybody loves it because it has gone out of our table. Now it's came back to our table. Very simple idea, but you do not notice until you cut it into your head. So it's not your eye which sees things, it's your brain who sees things. So you activate the brain, suddenly you see things which you never saw. The story doesn't end here. Then they notice questions in this room, this is not the problem of potato only. It's the problem of all the vegetables grown in Europe. Vegetables. And in the vegetable industry in Europe, it has a formal name for in the industry. These are known as ugly vegetable. That's the formal name. They call it ugly vegetable. Nobody buys ugly vegetable. So what do the farmers do? They throw it away. Because nobody buys. What is wrong with these ugly vegetables? Simple, again the shape issue. You have a cucumber, which is heavy on the top, slim on the bottom, nobody wants to buy it. So you can see any vegetable is a wrong shape. If you put it in your grocery shop, in the grocery chain, consumers will walk away. In the grocery chain in your shop, you want all the vegetables to be in a military formation. If it's a little deviation, you throw it out. This is ugly vegetable. It destroys the whole thing. Nobody comes near it. So they thought, why don't we buy up all the ugly vegetables? Chop it off. Once you chop it off, you don't know what shape it was. And put it ready to cook vegetables. Beautiful package, ready to cook vegetables. Cheap. And the housewives love it. Now I say, well, hot idea. It's a social business. So social business is not a concept which ends there. It's a way of looking at things. Suddenly you see things differently. We always complain. It's a worldwide complaint. I'm sure you'll be studying again and again about this. In agriculture, farmers grow lots of things, work very hard under very adverse circumstances to do that, but they don't get the price they deserve. Same item which farmers don't get the price, consumers in the final market pay a very high price. Mismatch. Producers don't get anything. He's hardly trying to cover his costs, pay his lenders, so he doesn't have to commit suicide. That's his worries. Somebody buys it from him at the harvest season, very cheap, because everybody's trying to sell. And take advantage and sells in the final market in a very expensive way. It's a tradition. If you look at item by item, cotton growers, what they get is a fraction what the cotton consumers pay. So somebody in between get the price, make the money, middleman. Coffee growers, you buy a cup of coffee for $4, $5, a cup of coffee, fancy coffee. But for that cup of coffee, probably the coffee grower got a couple of cents or 3 cents for that cup. But you bought it for $4. Who got the rest? We don't worry about it. We see how to make more money by the coffee business. Our goal, that's how we are taught in the classroom, goal and make more money. Whether the coffee growers get a good price or not, that's not our business. Make sure you buy the cheapest possible price for the grower so that you can make big margin. You see, logic is different. But in the social business, you reverse the logic. How to bring all this $4 per cup money that you create back to the producers who produced it? How do you do it? You create an intermediary company, social business company. Take the coffee from the growers and process it, whatever you have to do, and sell it in the final market. Oops, yes, I know. It's dangerous thing. So, it's possible. Anybody can do that. You don't have to do that nationwide. You can do small things, practice it. Buy the things from the producer, sell it in the final market, bring the money back to them, minus the cost of operation that you have. 17 changes. That's a social business opportunity. Anybody can do that. So we go on and on and on. One thing led to another. We got the microcredit. We encourage the children of the families of microcredit going to school, college, universities, get the education loan, give them scholarships. And then they don't have jobs. In Bangladesh, there are not too many jobs. And there are a massive number of young people coming every day, every year. What do? No jobs. Then I had to respond to that. My response was, why are you looking for jobs? Who told you to have jobs? Of course, we cannot answer that question. They thought, what a silly question he's asking. Everybody has to have a job. Then I tell them, a job is a wrong idea. Did your teacher talk to you about the jobs? How did you get that idea? It's from your book. This idea of job was to be removed from all the books in the old heads in the past century, because the new century should come clean of jobs. What do we do? See, you get up every morning and repeat to yourself, I'm not a job seeker, I'm a job creator. Think like a job creator. Act like a job creator. Being a job seeker makes you small. You are at the mercy of other people. No human being should be at the mercy of another person. That's the first principle of human being. Why should you have everything that you want? And I tell you, human being was never born on this planet to work for somebody else. That's not how we came to this planet. In this planet, when we in the past years, when we were in the caves, we are not running around cave after cave with a job application. That's not what we did. Our history is we are the gatherers, we are the hunters, we are the farmers. That's our history. We depend on ourselves. We took care of ourselves. That's what we are. Job is only a recent thing. Came out of the wrong thinking. People were taught into wrong ideas. That you have to work for somebody else. Nobody questioned, why should I work for somebody else? What's wrong with me? What he got, I got everything too. Why should I work for him? And I insist on them explaining. I said, human beings are all about creativity. All human beings packed with unlimited creativity. If you accept the job, you are surrendering your creativity. You become a smaller being than what you are. Because you, from now on, you'll be taking orders. That's the job. And you treat yourself to a tiny little person what you are. You are a massive human being. You become a small human being to fit the slot. And you become used to the repetitive job, creativity. Your creativity is only a small part of which you need the rest to be sacrificed. By the end of your life, you will not recognize who you are anymore. Because you have lost everything. So why should you accept that? Why don't you become what you are? You are an entrepreneur. Change the world. That's what you are. Well, it sounds good when you talk about it. But the real question is, how do we do it? They say, we don't know how to become an entrepreneur. We don't have the money to become an entrepreneur. I said, that's a shame on you. Because your mother didn't say that. Your mother is an illiterate woman. Never left her village in her entire lifetime. She dared to decide to take a loan of 3,000 taka, 4,000 taka, whatever the bank was given, to start a business. You were born in her, in this family. Your mother is the one who did that. And you went to the school, you got your degree, now you're telling me you don't know what to do with yourself. If your illiterate mother can know what kind of business she will be doing, how she'll be running her business and pay back and get more money and so on. It's a shame on the school which changes you from an entrepreneur to a person who's looking for mercy from other people. So go back to your mother. That's the best school you can have. Learn from her how she began. And for the last 20 years, 25 years, she's making this business bigger and bigger. Learn how to run the business, make it 10 times bigger. And find out where she got the money, how she got the money. And that's it. So it's a daily reference. It's your mother is doing that. It's not something I'm pulling something out of the sky. If 9 million illiterate women in Bangladesh can do that, can become entrepreneurs. Are we saying that educated young people don't know how to become entrepreneurs? Or it has been destroyed by our educational system? They had it fresh, but we made sure, we made every effort that you forget you ever had any entrepreneurial ability in you. That's the success of our education system. What else? So what do? We create a fund called Social Business Fund. Ask these young people, come with a business idea. Talk to each other, talk to your mother. Come with a business idea. Once you can explain what's your business idea, we'll invest all the money in your business. We'll become your partner. So you will be running your business, as you explained. And when you're successful in business, give us the money back, what we gave you. Because we're a social business, we don't want to make money off of it. All we want to do is to put you in the orbit, so you can fly as far as you can go. So that's our job. In the beginning, they are hesitating, is it really true? They're getting into more trouble, like they have their parents were worried in the beginning, from day to same thing. We assure that, look, our principal is right there. We don't reject anyone, so don't be afraid, oh, they will reject my case. We don't reject anyone. That's our principle. All we can say, the first round when you brought it, he needs improvement. Why don't you go back, we'll help you work together and make sure that you come up with clear ideas and so on. So we'll be working together until it comes to a level that we can invest. So we don't abandon you. Don't reject you. And when you start the business, business has ups and downs, it can be failure, like the flood will destroy many of those businesses. We said we never abandon you. You may fail. It's not your business, it's our business. We are your partner. 95% of your money is our money, 5% is your money. So we are as much worried as you are. So we'll work together to make it successful in the second round. And we'll continue with it until you are successful. And then gradually you return the money, you're on your own if you don't need us. If you need us, you come back again. You're here. This is a venture fund. But what's the difference between the conventional venture fund and our fund? In conventional venture fund, they want to make more money out of you. Get as much as they can get out of you. We said, no, we're not getting your money. All money is yours. We'll just return the money that we gave you. Now, thousands and thousands of young people come with business ideas, keep on investing, and that's it, it works. Once you open the door, people see that it happens. So people always say, are you sure it can happen? The only statement they will make, not all people are born to be entrepreneurs. I said, don't tell me that. I see every person is born to be entrepreneurs. Look at the microcredit. We never say we will not give somebody money because she is not an entrepreneur. She, in the beginning, she is pleading with us, I don't know anything. Please don't give me the money. I said, no, don't worry about it. Think about something. You'll come up with some money. We were patient with her. And finally, months later, she said, I have this idea. I can buy some chicken and sell the eggs. That's fine. That's your business. If you put money on the table, sooner or later, everybody becomes entrepreneurs. Simply money is missing. That's the same route we come back to financial institutions. And that's where screwed up the whole system. So we go back to the system again and again. And the worst part of that system, this is creating enormous wealth disparity, income disparity. All the wealth through this financial institution primarily being amassed in fewer and fewer hands. 99% of the wealth of the entire world is in the hands of 1% of the population. 99% of the wealth of the world is the hand of the 1%. You call it a system, I call it a robber. It's not a system. And it gets worse. Next year, to less than 1% of the population of the entire world, which is a bigger number, less than 1% of the population will be only more than 99% next year. So no matter what we do, we are immaterial. Because we create a machine which sucks up everything from the bottom, puts it in the top. And that's where we become the mercenaries to make it happen. That's what we teach in the classrooms, how to make it continue. We don't want to have that. We don't want to be mercenaries for anybody. We want to create our own life, and a life for the whole world. So I sum up all these ideas into three zeros. Say, create a world of three zeros. Number one zero is zero poverty, because there's no